welcome, first of all, to the Aetherius Society. And we are having this very special talk by James Young. And the way this came about was, as you know, or many people know here, that we've been redoing the front of our property. And we were looking for a fountain for the far end. And we were talking to one of our close members, Simon Fox, up in Santa Barbara about this. And he said, what about a Genesa crystal? And I said, a what? And he told me briefly what it was and how it's good for gardens and this kind of thing. So he told me where to go and look online. And I went to the site and looked at it, and it was James' site. And I called him up, and he answered the phone, which is remarkable in itself. And he gave me a lot of time, explained very patiently what it was. However, it was not a fountain. I said, oh, we need a fountain. And so then we talked further, and he said, well, you can put it inside. And so we back and forth, a few weeks. And he was extremely helpful. Even excited about the prospect of using this sacred geometrical shape called the Genesa crystal as a fountain. And it just so happened, while we were getting through all the approval processes, that James tells me that he's going to be coming out to Los Angeles anyway. And he said, while I'm there, maybe I could help install it for you. And we said, yeah. And also, I'll give a talk on sacred geometry and how this crystal fits in. And so we're thrilled to bits to have James here giving this lecture. He's been working with the crystal for 25 years, I understand. Mm-hmm. He's been giving many, many lectures about sacred geometry, mainly in the East Coast, I presume. But we're very happy to have him on the West Coast. And I think he's happy to be here this time of the year. So welcome, James.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, I'm thrilled to be here. And I want to ask right off if the sound seems okay, not too much good, that I don't have to strain. And yeah, I'm thrilled to be here. I just got a message that it's -4 degrees. Back in my area in Maine, and feels like -15, so it's like, okay. I'm thinking, I think I need to put on my socks before I walk out on the patio. So it's wonderful out here, and Brian and I have given this talk actually in Santa Cruz twice, and in Dallas, and a lot of times in Vermont at the Dowsers Society meetings, and there's an interesting bunch. So. And we have a pretty short hour here, but I'd just like to take you on a short walk through that time to maybe just give you a little taste of what this is about. What do we mean by sacred geometry, and what is this object? There's one like the fountain called the Genesa crystal. And how does that tie together? So if we took that walk, maybe through a nice natural setting, think of the things that sort of catch your eye. What are the little things you really notice? A beautiful flower, or I call them like the nuggets of interest, like a pine cone. It's a pretty amazing thing. It's like, and those eye-catching things, it might be the color that might be part of it. But very often we really seem to notice geometric forms and repetitions and patterns that we are more or less attracted to. And that's geometry. That's geometric form. And just the fact that it grows in nature makes it sacred in itself. And so that's one definition of sacred geometry, is just natural forms. And but so we see this geometry a lot in flowers, because they're like little flags, little buttons, little icons that really capture us. And they're symmetrical, and we sort of can gaze into them. And that's geometry, looking you in the face, and you looking at it. We see it in minerals. You know, what's one of the most precious things you can give to somebody you love but a crystal, you know, and an organic form, but something about its crystalline structure really has us captivated. And so one question was, why is this called a Genesa crystal? And the man who coined that phrase was really saying that this is all crystalline structures. Chemicals tend to latch together, particularly minerals, when they're cooling, and form combinations and lattices that along these lines of these angles and whatever. So that's what a mineral crystal is. And this object, this circular object, is called a crystal in name. And it creates a little confusion. Some people think rocks are in it. But a lot of people who have mineral crystals like to put them in that shape and feel like that kind of regenerates them. And maybe it does because they're resonating to, you know, geometric structures. There's a geometry to music in that when it really comes down to it, those are all vibrations at very specific rates. Each tone has its own megahertz rating. But then music that we like is a matter of timing. And that pacing and timing is pattern. And then the lyrical part of music is when that timing gets delayed or sped up or gets catchy. And that really captivates us. But you could also say that there's a geometry to it. A quote that I like a lot is by a man named Michael Schneider, who makes a delightfully friendly book about all of this stuff called A Beginner's Guide to Constructing the Universe. And it's a wonderful book because you can just read a page at a time. He takes the numbers 1 through 10 and discusses them at length and covers everything that I'm talking about and much more. So his quote that I like is, when we look at a five-petaled flower, we're seeing the flag of life, the self-reproducing force of life made visible as geometric harmony. In every flower, we are literally gazing into the face of the infinite. And when I first read that, I realized that a lot of flowers are five-petaled. You know, and whereas I think of symmetry as fours and sixes and eights, you know, but it's a lot of five-petaled flowers. The crystal question. Crystals then, this is also Schneider, crystals then may be considered frozen music, holding the proportions of musical intervals in the relationship of their corners, edges, and faces. The forms of nature configure as visual music. Crystalloidal tectonics is a term used to describe nature's rhythmic architectural designs in three dimensions. So there's geometry taking place in quite a span. Understanding of this, or the interest in it, or the play with it, this geometry stuff, I like to think of as kind of a gateway, because I've been amazed at how this is a great set for building these kind of things. And prior to a talk or whatever, you could lose me in the study for hours as, oh, you could take the center of this to the end of it. It's like I get going and going, and then I sort of wonder where I've been. And it's my own form of a meditation. I can't say what, but it feels like a gateway into something else. And it's not that I specifically understand the mathematical formulas that's really not what's whizzing through my head, but all of a sudden I'll be working on something and I'll come back to something else that I just had an hour ago, these repeating proportions, repeating patterns. And so I consider that a gateway and a way to enter something else. And the early Greeks in the classical era, about 400 or 500 years before Christ, in the heyday of Athens, the golden age, when they built the Acropolis and whatever, we just studied this stuff ad infinitum. And they attracted really brilliant people who took number and mathematics to a kind of a spiritual art form. And they found so many repeating patterns in the study of the number and the sort of the rhythms of mathematics that they really felt like this was no mistake, that there was an order to the universe that could be understood or described through mathematics. Now, I'm usually aware when I say I'm giving a talk on geometry that some people go, really? And other people go, oh, geometry. And because and a lot of us got a bad deal in seventh grade. And it was presented as kind of a grueling task, and four people totally understood it and made everyone else feel kind of dumb. And I think it's a sad part of that kind of education. But everyone had to do it. You had to do arithmetic and math and algebra. I responded to geometry myself, but I knew a lot of other people just it was, of course, they hated because they didn't understand. They were left behind. And then they had to prove things. So those proofs are grueling. And they were grueling back then for the Greeks, too, but they had a taste for it. So I'm not really into the proofs, but just the comprehension. In that era, Plato basically started, or was sort of like the headmaster of the school of Athens. And he attracted to all the minds that were interested in this and had all these thinkers and mathematicians and even artists and musicians studying this fascination with number. And it wasn't just the Greeks. The Mayans were incredible with numbers. And they developed a calendar way back then that just ran out a few years ago. But they really, really thought in terms of number. And the Egyptians, one of the great libraries of all this knowledge was at Alexandria, and unfortunately it burned. But a huge body of knowledge was there. A later mathematician named Fibonacci we'll come back to him and his contribution to this. In modern times, we might, in terms of geometry, we might think of Buckminster Fuller, who took basically this shape and broke it down into smaller triangles and was fascinated in enclosing space for any reason you want, for shelter or for storage or whatever, even ideas about covering whole cities. But the geodesic dome was his creation. But this is called an icosahedron. The icosahedron was not his creation. This is in nature. That's where that comes from. And I'm going to just show you one slide. Yeah. This is the school of Athens depicted by Raphael in about 1510. It took him 2 years to do this this whole room, and this is one of the faces of the room. And right next door was the Sistine Chapel, and Michelangelo was lying on his back on a staging, working there. So this is the great Italian Renaissance, and this was an homage to the classical Greek era, it's just kind of a fun one. because he pulls in into one painting some of all the sort of famous mathematicians and philosophers, and he's got Plato here and Aristotle. I think this guy is Zoroaster, the Zoroaster religion. It wasn't clear whether this was Archimedes here, but he's drawing with a compass down on the ground. And so he sort of got the whole club going. And and this is Pythagoras here working on a book. And but what's kind of fun about this to me is that it's a great painting. And if you Google it, you can really zoom in on all these characters. But he had to make these dead people look like something. So he chose the gang of artists around him and drew them in. And so for Plato, he's got Leonardo da Vinci. And I'm not sure whether it's this guy as Michelangelo, but one source said it was this guy, which is kind of interesting that he's. And then another fun thing is there's Raphael himself, the artist. He snuck in there too. So it's kind of an in-joke in this great classic painting. And this is Pythagoras. And I'm not sure of the story of the creation of this, but here he is holding, you know, the most basic geometric form, the tetrahedron. And here's a depiction here of the Pythagorean theorem. Now, I said there'd be no formulas in it, but you know that a squared plus b squared equals c squared. And but here it is depicted, and showing it this way, it makes sense. This is a, and it's a squared, and this is b, and it's squared. So this is c, and it's squared. And if this is 3, and this is 4, and this is 5, then the square is 9 here, and 4 fours is 16 here, and add those up, and you get 25. And the first time I saw that, it just made perfect sense to me. Prior to that, it had been another formula with numbers, and you're supposed to break it down, and that's another exercise. But to finally just get it through a picture really meant a lot to me. There's a lot of other symbology in here. This is the meander pattern. Oh, you can't see where I'm pointing. In this wall in back there, that meander pattern, that's everywhere. You see that in decoration. That's the essence of the labyrinth, if any of you are familiar with labyrinths. So anyway, we could do the lecture on this picture. But there he is, quite an interesting dude, Pythagoras. And I always like to say he didn't develop the Pythagorean theorem to terrorize seventh graders. He was really these discoveries of, you know, that a squared plus b squared equals c squared. It's like this was like when they realized that was always true for every right triangle. This was like a mystery of the universe. You know, this was like a basic truth. During the time of the Great School of Athens, either Plato himself or Plato, his school, developed a basic truth among many and found a set of solid shapes that sort of met a rule. And the rule was there are shapes with straight edges. And that's the straight edge, see? Called polygons, all right? Any shape with straight sides is a polygon. That's a three-sided polygon. And then, but so they were looking, the rule was they were looking for regular polygons so that each side was the same and each angle was the same. All right, so a basic polygon, you know, it was like, so a regular polygon is a triangle. Can you imagine what the next one is with four sides? Is a square. Five sided is a pentagon. I don't know how well I can draw it at this scale. And I'm, okay, let's go to the hexagon. And let's see. Pretty good pentagon. Yes, okay. So, and then it could go on to seven, eight, you know, and you begin to approach what looks more like a circle when you have a lot of sides. But so these are all the regular polygons, and then the question was, how many shapes can you make, three-dimensional shapes, where all the sides are regular polygons? It has to be a triangle or a cube or a pentagon. And there's a reason why you can't, the hexagon doesn't work, because if you connect another hexagon, it will lay flat in a plane, as you've seen on many old-fashioned bathroom floors. You can't wrap that plane around up into a three-dimensional shape. So now we're only limited to these three as being in that club, and there are only five shapes. There aren't hundreds, there are only five. Now, there are a lot of shapes that could combine, be made out of triangles and squares, or triangles and pentagons, and so forth. A soccer ball is pentagons and hexagons. And I remember a joke on myself was trying to understand all this, and I was on a trip in Costa Rica, and I was trying to visualize it. Is a soccer ball just all pentagons, or what is a soccer ball? And then we came to a park, and we got out, and these kids were playing soccer. So I walked all the way down to the end of the park, and I was kind of trying to run along and say, well, one, two, three. And finally, I noticed they were, so I stood behind the goal, and when they kicked it out, I would like catch it and like the starting, okay, here, you can have it back. So that's my field research. So yeah, you can make a really nice nice shape out of that, but and there's reference to those 12-sided balls in writings from that era of the ancient Greeks. They didn't do the combination, they just did this one. But if you sewed that together with an animal skin and then somehow inflated it, that it did a pretty good job of making a ball. But they were onto it back then, and so it hasn't changed much. So anyway, there are only five. There are only five shapes that meet the test, and just gonna just take you through them. So the most basic primitive shape, the most basic polygon is a triangle. Out of two legs, you can't enclose a space. So you need at least three to make a shape, and if they're regular, it's a regular triangle. And then to make that into a three-dimensional shape, start with a triangle and then add three more. But actually, if you take the corners, you're starting with three corners, and just add one more in now the third dimension. And this is sort of a primitive, I call it. It's the most basic three-dimensional shape there is. Now, we're looking at the regular ones, so we can see it, that everything's the same size. And all these shapes, we're just going to quickly track how many faces there are and how many corners there are. Vertices are called. And then how many edges there are. the green struts that it took to make these. And these are fun to construct, by the way. There's a way to do it with straws. And a friend of mine who teaches this and teaches about Genesa called me one time and said, I have a great way to do models for kids in a classroom. Toothpicks and dots. Dots, the candies. I guess the kids, he'd be walking by, how are you doing? Oh, you need some more dots, don't you? But you can make, you know, some of these models quite successfully. They ascribe the five elements to these, and fire for the tetrahedron, and color would be red or orange. The next one is a four-sided polygon, a square, which we're pretty familiar with, and then six squares make a cube. And I've always thought of the square as the most, you know, product of the human being, boxes, buildings, right angles, and whereas nature was curves and, you know, domes and flowers and things like that. But the cube is pretty mystical, I've found. And one way to imagine that is if this was a cubical room, and it's pretty close, and you don't have to, but if I asked you to close your eyes and imagine the room, or imagine you're in a racquetball court, you could, in your imagination, point to the, say, upper far right corner of the room. You have a pretty good sense of where it was. No matter where you're sitting in the room, you can sort of imagine where the boundaries of the floor are. You can even, without even turning your head, imagine behind you where the lower left corner is behind you, or the upper left corner. We're familiar with it, and we're always sitting in rooms like this, and squares. If you try the same exercise with a cube like this, it's really hard to picture it. If you were sitting right down here, there's a set of three lower corners and then three upper corners, and then there's the one over your head. And I find it really hard to imagine being in this. And it's like my whole reference gets thrown by that. And it's the same with this shape. If you have one of these Genesa crystals, there's a choice whether to set it this way, in which it's, the cube is contained in it. And you can see a surface here and here and here. But when you turn it up on its end, it becomes something else entirely. You'll notice the one outside, we set it this way, and it's nice because it has an equator. So all I'm trying to say is the cube can actually be quite mystical. We'll come back to a little more of that when we move on to Genesa. But the next one that can be made is another one that can be made out of triangles. And it's the eight-sided figure, so that means it's an octahedron, octa for eight. This one now has six corners, and it needs 12 struts to make it, 12 edges. And I do want to point out that the upper half of this is what's called a pyramid, because the base is a square. And then there are four regular triangles leaning in from that square. That's a pyramid. And the pyramids of Egypt are based this way. This is really a tetrahedron. It's not actually a pyramid. It's pyramidal, but it's not the true pyramid. So this is two pyramids, you know, together to make the octahedron of eight sides. But there's also two pyramids going in this way. You can see these two, and there's another two going in this way. So it's octahedron was given the element of air, and its color would be blue and violet. Stepping back, the good old cube was assigned to the element of earth, could be orange or yellow. Gonna jump to the icosahedron, which has the most sides, and this is the other three of these, you'll notice, can be made out of triangles. And this takes 20 triangles. And it has 12 corners and 30 struts to build it. It was given the element water, the color green or pink. And then the final element of ether, which is kind of, to me, a mystical gateway. The concept of ether is pretty broad as to what that can actually mean. Space or thought or God or whatever, but was given to the shape made out of pentagons, 12 pentagons. So 12 in Latin is dodeca, so it's a dodecahedron. And it has 20 corners, and again, 30 struts, as does this one, which is kind of interesting. And when I have these kicking around and I'm talking with them, people over, there's always the people who like to build with, you know, anything. They'll start stacking them up, you know, and trying, and it doesn't go very well. And oh, there's triangle to triangle. You know, you could, and it's to get people playing with them and looking to stack them like they were bricks or blocks or whatever, just building blocks. And they, well, that works, but then that doesn't. You know, it's like they're not really a very good set of toys. But the fascination with this is how they do stack is by nesting. And so the, if you take the tetrahedron, the number of faces is the number, the same as the number of corners. So if I take the center of each face and put a dot and connected those with lines, I'd have another smaller tetrahedron inside of it. So it's dual to itself. In other words, the number of corners and faces are the same. So if you take the center point, you're going to replicate the same shape. If you look at the other sheet, this is pointing out that it's taking those points, it's a tetrahedron on the upper left, and then the center point of each of those triangles is the beginning of an emerging tetrahedron. And in this case, it was showing that tetrahedron starting to grow. The red one's starting to grow. And the middle frame, it's grown to the point where it's two tetrahedra together, and making a really interesting shape at that point. And then it continues to grow and absorb the original brown one. So now the points of the brown one are at the center of all the red triangles. And so you get this sort of morphing going on. And this is the result of that center frame where they're both the same size. And I'm going to just slowly turn this because sometimes it's hard to see it. But there's a white tetrahedron and a blue tetrahedron. They're both the same size and they're nested to each other. And surprisingly enough, we get a very cubical shape out of this. So with this tetrahedrons, which are the ones that are the hardest to fit in, you know, we take two of them and we describe a cube. And this is called a Merkaba. And there's a lot of thought and study of this in Kabbalah, in the Jewish religion. And there's quite a meditation with this that I read one time. It's the guiding of the meditation. It's many, many, many steps, but you imagine you're in the white tetrahedron, like sitting in the middle of it, and you imagine that you also have an upside-down blue tetrahedron around you. Now, I had you just imagine the cube and whatever, but now you're imagining. It takes a lot of imagining, and it helps to really, really work with it. Then you imagine that the white one, and you could forget the blue one maybe for a while, but you could imagine you're sitting in the white one and it's rotating. And once you get, and I'm getting it. There's like a point to the triangle, it's coming around, and now the point of the triangle is in front of me. You know, it's like, okay, you know, like this one's, oh, I can see that. And then there'll be two in front of me, and they're sweeping around on the floor. And there's one above me, and it's not moving over my head, but everything's rotating around it. You can sort of get going with that and picture that. But then the task is to picture the other one, and maybe you just imagine that over your head, going the other way. And so it's turning the other way, and then the meditation is what do we have, the blue one upside, to imagine that happening to both at once. That's a lot of head work, but actually taking it in bites and imagining it slowly, it's really quite a visualization, because suddenly you have it, and they're going in opposite directions around you. That's kind of a gateway. So that's the Merkaba, and the cube and the octahedron, if you look at the chart, you may have noticed that the cube and the octahedron sort of are dual to each other in that one has six faces and eight corners, and the other has eight corners and six corners. And so if you take the center point of each cube and connect the dots, then you would get this octahedron inside of it. So all the points, the six points of the octahedron, are at the center of the six faces of the cube. Now, in order to build this model, I had to add something out here to connect to. Otherwise, this is just false. So put in these diagonals, and lo and behold, I've got a tetrahedron. So now we're nesting. We've got the octahedron, the tetrahedron, and the cube sort of all neatly nested around the center. And to go back to the cube and the tetrahedron, I was well into this for several years before I realized that if you take a cube and next time you have a box, you know, like this, something comes in, save it, you know, and start drawing on it. But if you connect, make a diagonal across the box, well, let's say the box is on the table like that, and make a diagonal here and a diagonal across the back surface, and then just connect those. You know, that's going to attach here, so connect that down there and that there, and you will have a tetrahedron. And it really astounded me. I'm sorry. It was quite a discovery. And it also came up when I realized I could slide a tetrahedron into a box to ship it. So So, octahedron and the cube are dual to each other, and then we get to the king and queen of this set, and the same thing happens. If I take the center point of these 12 pentagons and connect them, I didn't do it that way. I will have the 12 surfaces will be these 12 points. It will be much smaller than this one, the one that would fit in here. But the graphic is showing that same thing happening, where it's starting on the left, the yellow dodecahedron with little points, and then as it grows, you can see it's starting to morph. And in the middle, it kind of reaches an interesting point where they're both about the same diameter. And then at the far right, it's turned into a dodecahedron. It starts with an icosa, 20-sided figure. So they're dual to each other. So they're a pair that are very closely intertwined and related. And if we take, so I sort of have the tetrahedron, and then I've got these two are dual to each other, and these two are dual to each other. And again, it took me a long time to realize that there was a cube in here. I didn't know if there really was an association, but this is a smaller dodecahedron, and there are points on this that make a cube. So that now connects us. If we have the cube, then we know we have the octahedron. And if we have the cube, we also have the tetrahedron. And so here's the tetrahedron, you know, living inside of the dodecahedron. So they are all nested in. And so what initially seemed like impossible building blocks are actually, they build on each other really nicely, because they also build nicely in pattern. Like, if you take a whole bunch of these and put them on a flat surface and line them all up, because these are triangles, you can cover the whole surface with the bottom triangle of a bunch of tetrahedra, if you're fussy about your Latin. But then the next row of tetrahedra don't go so well. They don't fit in. You know, now you can imagine this being rows of this and rows of this, and so it's sort of a spiky thing. And to try and now get a set in that next row doesn't really work well at all. What does fit in, and I don't know if this isn't the right size, but octahedra will fit in to the spaces between this row, and then you can do another row of tetrahedra, and on it goes. So now I'm beginning to think of crystalline structure, and how is salt built, and how is you know, all these beautiful minerals. How do they connect? But I also think we're beginning to get, on a molecular level, and atoms, they're bound by the same rules here. They can only fit together in so many ways. In fact, who was it who said this morning, it's like, oh, this is reminding me of chemistry class. Well, it is chemistry class. There's other forces going on, but there's a lot of mechanics to the chemistry. Things just will or will not fit. And so geometry is really crucial, right down on a cellular level. And to understand it a little bit more mechanically maybe lets us understand it a little bit more chemically and philosophically too. So this plant biologist named Daryl Langham, lived in Fallbrook, California, and in the 40s, he was quite an academic. He had five PhDs, brilliant man, big bear of a man with huge eyebrows, and everyone I've known who met him just loved him. But he was doing plant genetics way back then, and in that practice, you've got to have a farm, and you know he was worked a lot with sesame seeds. He was doing all these different strains and things like that, and he decided instead of rows, you know, rows and rows and rows, maybe lettered this way and numbered that way, because you've got to decide what you're going to crossbreed and then be able to go back and retrieve those seeds and crossbreed them with those. And you could do it all like a spreadsheet, like a graph. He did it in circles. He liked to make circles that, like a whole bunch of pennies on the table, if they nested in nicely, he would put six plants per circle. And that made a nice way of watering them. They sort of made a bowl kind of in each one. And then he had a whole system of notation with the circles. I don't know the system of notation, but he could give a piece of paper to any helper who maybe didn't even speak English and tell him, I want you to get this and this and this and bring them back to me, you know. And then he sort of threw that geometry into three dimensions. And he was just a fascinating mind. He loved playing with this stuff, and as the Greeks did. So he took a well. There's several ways to get to this, but if you take a cube, and if you can draw a cube, you could just try this. Take the midpoint of each leg of the cube, and connect them. And then you'll get another square on the face of each one. And then if you chopped off, and I can do it here, or some of them, crack. If you chopped off those corners, let's see if I have the result all set. Yeah, here it is. If you chopped off the corners, you would now have a face that was just a square. I'll take off two corners. Whoop, crack. And kept going like that, you'd now have these squares and these triangles that came from, you know, chopping off the corners, and you'd get something like this. And this now has eight triangles and six squares, because we chopped off corners on the eight corners of a square cube, and we had the original six surfaces of a cube. So eight-sided, that's the octahedron. And if we projected these triangular surfaces out, they would meet, and I would then get an octahedron. So geometry people, amazingly call this the cube octahedron. And Buckminster Fuller called this vector equilibrium. Because he saw a lot of balance here in all the different forces going on. So this figure is the essence of this. And you can see that this nice rounded thing has eight triangles and six squares. And it's a rounded vector equilibrium. And I'm going to just pull the cube out. That's my magic trick for the day. But another thing to notice when you have the cube octahedron, the white ones, and I'm going to aim it at you. The reason I marked those white ones is that's a hexagon. That's a six-sided figure. And if I had three other colors of straws, it would turn out that there's four hexagons. So another way to arrive at this shape would be four hexagons assembled together. And then if you took the hexagons and blew them out to a roundness instead of a hexagon and made them into circles, now you'd have four circles. And that's what this becomes. So it's really just four rings, evenly distributed around a sphere. And so he named this the Genesa crystal. And he just thought up that name, partly because he was a geneticist, and at that time he was in South America, so gene for genetics and SA for South America. And he sort of gave it a name. And he was always experimenting and playing with stuff. And his grandchildren said he was, after dinner, we'd be all out on the lawn, and he'd be giving us sticks, and you'd count the sticks and put your hand on top, and you had to be over there if you had this. And he had them all playing with number. And I really wish somebody had those games written down or whatever. But anyway, he gave this the name Genesa crystal, and then several years later, somebody from the East said, well, you know, Genesa means removing the obstructions to spiritual unfoldment. In Sanskrit, that's what Genesa means. And it's like, of course. Of course that would just happen. You know, of course I'd be planning a trip to L.A. and Brian would need a fountain. I mean, it just... stuff happens, you know. So this is the Genesa crystal, and that's what I make. That's how I got into this. The reason I got into that was a woman in Virginia named Michelle Smallwright. Anyone heard of her? The Perelandra Gardens. She makes flower essences, and maybe your friend who suggested this had heard about it. But she, in her garden workbook, and basically her, it's an interesting book because she's gardening with nature, and she's basically almost a dowsing kinesiology, asking questions, yes or no. But the idea is the wisdom of the plants and whatever. If should the peas go next to the carrots, will they, you know, are they good companion plants? You can look it up in Organic Gardening Magazine. You can ask at the Extension Service, and you'll get a lot of answers or whatever. But the answer might also just be right there in nature. And so, in a very simplistic way, it's like asking directly. But in her fascinating book about this kind of thing and all those applications, she mentioned the Genesa crystal and said it was great for the garden, great balancing energy for growing plants. And she also said, nobody makes these, but my husband Clarence has given you instructions on the back of the book on how to take maybe some wire or copper tubing and make a Genesa crystal. And there was a way you could make it out of paper first. And so I picked up on this and tried it. And then I didn't really like the way her husband made made it out of copper tubing. So I thought I'd improve on it a little. And I also discovered that making paper models, that this will weave. Any one strap will weave under and over and under and over. And it works all the way. There's a symmetry there where that all works. And so I brought that element to it. And then I told them I was doing this, and they said, do you want to do some business? Would you like to be in our catalog? And that's the beginning of the story of making these for me. That's how that happened. Going back to the cube, I just wanted to point out another fun thing. If you have a box and you have a rubber band, is to find that way to split a cube. And you can only see three legs at the moment, and I can see the other three, but that rubber band is in a hexagon. So that's the same as this thing going on. So you get four rubber bands to put around this, and then you'll have that vector equilibrium, that Genesa shape, right there in the cube. Or it's also fun, if you have a box, is to just draw all those on. And I could have a few more things about sacred proportion I'd just like to share with you. We're back in seventh grade. We got this thing about the circumference of a circle in relationship to its diameter. And if this was 1 across the circle, then this would be the proportion pi. And it had a decimal, 3.141, rounded off 6. It's 5.9, it goes on and on and on. It never resolves as a whole number. But we all got pi. Most people understood that. But then they never went on to the next one, which is called phi, which is the Greek letter phi. Sometimes there's legs there. And that is a proportion if I can get this right here, of, and this is just the numbers. The numbers really don't mean anything, but it is a proportion. It's a ratio. It's if this was 1, this would be 1.618, and on and on and on and on and on. So it's about 1.5, a little more than 1.5. And the thing about phi is kind of interesting. If I knock off a square, this being the square, I think I'm going to come out all right. I think I'm pretty close. If I knock off a square, I will get another phi proportioned rectangle. It's called the golden section. And maybe you've heard of that, the golden section. And then we go back to the Greeks and the Greek architecture, the Parthenon, and a lot of those rectangles were in golden section. It's also called the golden mean. Mean just means a ratio, 1 over 1.618. And then if you take a square out of that, let's see, keep rotating the same way. We take a square out of that, we get another. And then a square out of that one, we get another. And another. So I'm rotating this way, and another. So now if you take the same point on each rectangle, like that's the lower left, but then we turn this one to the right, so then we're taking this one, and then we turned that to the right, and I think we'd be at this one, and then this one, and this one, and, am I right, this one. This keeps going smaller and smaller in basically a spiral. And what we're getting now is this. I'm going to draw it again because maybe we'll hit. And you recognize that from?
Shells.
From nature. This is the nautilus shell. There's so many beautiful, cross sections of taking the so this phi proportion, which maybe just sounded like a bunch of numbers, is actually very much tied into nature. It's a natural number, and I think that's what makes it sacred. And it shows up everywhere, it's all through here. If we took certain measurements of certain in certain ways, we keep coming up with this phi proportion. Growth, and this is growth, each chamber of the nautilus shell is 1.68 times as large as the previous one. The chamber is being first, it's, let's see, this way, this way, this way. Yeah, each chamber is going like this. And each chamber is proportionately larger, this amount. It's all through us, it's through our bodies. If this is one, this is close to phi, 1.618. And if this is one, then this is 1.618. And don't have it with me, but there's a pair of calipers that as you open the calipers, there's three legs, and as you open it or close it, it'll keep it that proportion, and you can go around and measure all the parts of the body that are in that ratio. And so it's a... it's a natural number, let's put it that way. And the other thing that's you might have heard of or not was a number sequence by the Italian mathematician Fibonacci. And tell me if I spell it. Fibonacci, I think. And this has a rule. If we start with zero, it's a sequence of numbers, okay? So zero and then one. And from then on, you just follow the rule. We add, is that big enough? Can people read it? We add the previous, to get the third number, we add the previous two. So the next number would be one and zero. Then we add, to get the next number, we add the previous two. And keep calling them right out, one, three. And adding, now we're adding two and three, five. Adding three and five. Keep going. 13. 34, and so forth. And that, of course, could go on forever.
One more.
All right.
56.
21 and 34. 55. Yeah, so we're getting into 11s going on here. Okay, so this is a sequence of numbers, and if you study plant growth, this comes up all the time, this sequence. Fibonacci himself had a whole, it's a pretty complicated thing of you have two rabbits and they start to breed. They're ready to breed again about the time that the youngsters can breed. And so you get this population growth at a certain kind of rate. And that's all based on the Fibonacci sequence. What gets clearer as you go further is that if I take 55 and divide it by 34, and if somebody has a calculator, they could give me a number. Well, that's what happens, is that it approaches, the further out you go, it gets more and more accurate. If you divide 2 into 3, you get 1.5. But as you get further along, this will start to approach 1.618. In other words, the Fibonacci sequence is basically a growth rate in phi proportion, just like the nautilus shell was a growth rate in phi proportion. and Phi is all through the natural forms. And one interesting anecdote was, you know, in the helix of DNA, there are the ladders connecting them. And I could be wrong the exact physiology, but something about the 23rd chromosome has a node in the about here, and the human chromosome, and that node should be in phi proportion in its distance across. Okay, for that particular 23rd chromosome. And they found that sufferers of Lou Gehrig's disease and Alzheimer's, and there's one other in that group, that one thing they noticed, and it's not an explanation yet, but that this was off. This was not in the right place. And so, of course, people have strange diseases. Something's off. Something's not, didn't quite reproduce quite right or whatever. But that's one thing they noticed. Was that always should be in that proportion, and it wasn't. And so I just wonder, this is a real leap here, but just to meditate on Phi and the golden section and that proportion, you know, what parts of your body maybe want to be in that, you know, in that proportion? Go ahead. Dr. Langham gave it the name, and he saw it in this round form. The actual shape of these 12 intersections being in that relationship really comes from this, you know, the geometry. Dr. Langham didn't invent the geometry. you know, a prayer spinner, the Tibetan spinner, my son had one after his travels, and it was a really old one, whatever. But the weight on the end that was used to spin it around was this little bronze sort of cast thing, and it was the cube octahedron. So I just sort of liked that. That was sort of a whole different culture coming from a whole different place. But so back to your question, it was like. One thing I've said is that in some ways, if you wanted to choose one sort of icon for all the Platonic solids, this is a really good one, because we have the cube, we have the octahedron, and then we've shown how they all beget the others. So for me, it's the flag of life in that it's the symbol for this kind of sacred geometry. A lot of people use these as the same way they might believe in mineral crystals to have properties for healing. I don't make any claims as to what this does, but I have wonderful conversations with people who kind of use these to their advantage. And the only thing I can say is it makes a good vessel for your intentions. Maybe there's a resonance here of it reflecting, you know, sort of the natural order. And then if that helps the growing things or create. A lot of people like it in the idea of sort of cleansing chaotic energy. A lot of therapists like it to keep the office kind of. One thing that's kind of cool about this, and I wasn't able to bring the model, if you build this out of sticks and surgical tubing as the connector, so they're wiggly connections, you can fold this up into almost all the Platonic solids. So that's another example of how, I think that's what Fuller might have been getting at with vector equilibrium. It's representing all these shapes. One thing I'm going to say for those of you who are of the church and will be seeing this is that if you look at it the way I'm holding it, there's a circle aiming right at you. And so it looks like a ball, looks like a circle. But if you take a certain angle, and I'm saying it for you guys right there, it might look like it's leaning over. Like there's something missing over here. And you get that lopsided view, several places around. And I've had people ask me about that, and I say, well, just walk around it. and for a long time, when I had them around the house, I was always twisting and aiming it. So when I came in the room, I saw a perfect round. You know, And then I decided, I kind of like it when it's kind of drunk and it's kind of leaning over sideways. Here's one, though, that is kind of similar to what you're talking about, Don. Let's say you can take a cube and there's a sphere that will fit around it and there's a sphere that will fit inside of it. And then you could calculate the volumes of both those cubes and what's their proportion and things like that. And you're off and running on these sort of experiments. You can take a triangle and circle the triangle, or you can take a circle and square the circle, make the square around it. So Kepler was more of an astronomer, and he got fascinated with, let's take sort of an easy one. Okay, this corner here is a big tetrahedron, and this is the sphere that cages that tetrahedron. And then he's got, does this look like a cube here? Maybe it's the cube that cages that sphere. Okay, so then they're going to have a certain ratio to each other. And then he's nesting all the way down in. There's the dodecahedron here, and a icosahedron here, and I think there's another tetrahedron. So he was doing that. That was his experiment. He was hoping he would stumble on the fact that those successive spheres with the platonic solids in a certain order, that he'd get the distance of the planets. And it's not true. It didn't work. But it's your question. It was like, well, what happens if you take that proportion and whatever? But then there are other things I did find that were sort of on that order. But that's what they were doing. They were trying all these different combinations and also trying to see if there was a grand master plan as to how the whole cosmos was laid out. I mean, the geometer's myth of the Greek times was that God, whatever that may be, laid out the whole universe with a straight edge and a compass. The original draftsman's tools, it's like, and you know what I mean by compass, right? The old one for drawing circles. If you have kids or grandkids, compass and a straight edge, you can start finding amazing things just by playing with it, getting them to play with it. One thing that Langham did with the Genesa crystal and his geometry, which was taking this geometry into certain use, is that, remember we said the cube in here was like a box here. And this is, by the way, a 12-inch diameter Genesa crystal. I can ship it in a 10-inch cubed box. Go figure that out. Genesa magic. But anyway, we were talking about, when we put that box up on end, things change. And down flat like this, we've got three axes, sort of like a weather vane, north, south, east, west, and above and below. And we're pretty used to that, across the room, and maps and things like that. When you do this, you're throwing those three axes into more of a double cone kind of, or an upside down teepee, or that kind of thing. So the three axes are in this relation, instead of this relation. And you can look at things differently that way. So one thing Langham would point out is that if you take the three prime colors blue, yellow, and red, and put them on that axis, or those three axes, then the mixture of red and yellow is down here, is orange. The mixture of blue and red is violet. And blue and yellow is green. And then this ends up that green and red are then considered the color complement. Now, we usually see this drawn out in a wheel, and that's a good way to look at it, the color wheel, and you go across to get the color complement. But he liked to think in the three dimensions. And and there's a fascinating set of cubes that I have where you're always red, always adding red when you go this way. Can you all see it? Or should I hold it up again? When you go this way along the axis, you're adding red. When you go this way, you're adding green. And when you go this way, you're adding yellow. And so you may have a combination of blue and red that's like in the purples, but if you go this way in the three-dimensional space, you're adding yellow. And he also, Langham, liked to build great big models so that the Genesa crystal was all around you, probably with the equator sort of about at the heart. And then practice where those three axes were. There was like red-green, there was blue-orange, and then there was yellow-violet. Like that. So, and then when you do that one, you could do it maybe with the other hand too. So you get out there in the morning and just start thinking of this. My God, pretty soon you're kind of doing
Tai Chi.
Tai Chi. And then there are the four circles. Imagine a little me inside there. They're the four circles. So there's like this one, the equator. And then there's, you know, this one. And then there's this one. And, and then this one. So the idea was you put that geometry around you and then experimented with different systems, like the color system. If you labeled, starting at one of those upper intersections and labeled the astrological signs, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and went around like that, put that around you, then it turned out that all the air signs grouped together and all the water signs grouped together and things like that. But he used this as a system of memory, and he called it mapping. And particularly this idea of these different axes. And for instance, with plants, if you're thinking of plants and you did, we could use this to help. If we did heat, temperature, if we did red if we did quite this hotter and cooler along this axis, wetter and drier, and more light, less light, then you could place in anywhere in the sphere around you different conditions. Like high desert could be hot, dry, and what was the other one?
Light.
And light. Or you could have hot, light, and very moist. Let me just pull up this. So if you went through the axes, and there might be a place where it was hot, dark, and dry. I can't read my writing. Hot, light, and wet would be like palm trees. And hot, dark, and wet would be the understory of the tropic, of the jungle situation. Hot, light, and dry might be cactus in the desert. And so basically, it was a system to, in three dimensions, categorize things. And I haven't been able to really do it, but he had a way of constructing a whole system like that and then collapse it like an umbrella. And he was able to, at any time, like pop that one open, and he could remember where things are. And so it was basically taking information and mapping it in a three-dimensional form. And sometimes I've found the different platonic solids are more or less appropriate for like a set of things. And some things are based on five, and a lot of things are based on three, and that kind of thing. So that was just another use of it. We no longer get the screen to project. Oh, it does. Oh, okay. Sorry, I'm just going to finish with one last thing.
Can I ask quickly, does size matter of the crystal?
It does, and it's. I usually have my customers just ask what they think they need. It's like, if somebody's heard that it's like cleanses the energy of the house, I don't say you need one in every room. But I also say aesthetically, is a great big one going to look right on your mantle? Probably not, or whatever. So what works visually? I make them because I find them incredibly beautiful. So I want that standard. But there was a lot of questions about the radius of effect of this effect, and Michelle Smallwright in the Paralandra Gardens thought a 2-foot diameter affected 2 miles. And then I asked some dowsers over many years, and like a 12-inch, they tested it out and said about a mile. So it seemed to be maybe roughly proportional that like 3-foot diameter might affect 3 miles. But what is the effect? We're talking about something very subtle. But the big turning point for me was when I started doing this was I built a 24-inch, and I liked it. This is kind of cool, It's like, and put it in the house, and the cat got in it and did not want to get out. And sadly, he was dying at that time, but that's the only place he wanted to be. And it was so touching. And then I later had other cats who weren't dying, and they loved curling up in the thing. And I was like, they haven't read any books. They haven't been influenced by Michelle Smallwright or
sometimes
whatever.
Cats know.
But yeah, there's something there. There was an article I read one time about a woman who was meditating on certain shapes and just had it in front of her while she was meditating. And she had drawn a hexagon and then connected the dots of all the corners of the hexagon. So let's just get this. And you also get a Star of David in there going on. And but then in her meditation, suddenly it popped into a three-dimensional shape. And it's like a wireframe model, which is what this was, of an octahedron. And so that fascinated me when I heard that, and I immediately had to do this. And that a lot of these patterns and two-dimensional shapes can be the shadow of a three-dimensional shape. I mean, that's a very common symbol. And sometimes that is sort of done in three dimensions. There's some car, I think, that had that. Can you all see? So it fascinates me a bit as to what is There, that's sort of an interesting one. And so we're sort of approaching a circle on the outside.
Yeah.
But I think a lot of it, though, is seeing in the simpler ones is looking at it, and you could even draw that hexagon and whatever, and looking at it and then suddenly seeing it as a three-dimensional object. So there's a simple hexagon and cross the lines, and then if it just tweaks a little bit that way, suddenly you see the cube. And that brings to me all kinds of questions about, you know, if we're seeing and thinking in a linear, two-dimensional way, are we recognizing the third dimension? I don't know if any of you have heard of a book called Flatland, but the whole book takes place in two dimensions, in Flatland. And there are these shapes, and there's sort of a story to it, and different shapes can fit through the door of different houses, and the house is just a border in Flatland. And that's okay, so that's the premise. They live in Flatland. But then one day something strange happens. There's a dot, which instantly turns into a circle and gets bigger and bigger and bigger, and then it gets smaller and smaller and smaller and goes away. And they go, what's that? And it takes some years to figure out that that was a sphere passing through Flatland. It just touched, and it was a point. And then it turned into a small circle, and then it got bigger and bigger, and then came through. And so they were trying to visualize what some of these things were that were coming through their land, their consciousness, where the only clues were what they could read in the flat land, but actually three dimensions were being described. So here we are living in the third dimension and fourth dimension with time. It's like, what are we a shadow of? You know, that's my big question. You know, what are we trying to perceive? And that's, what are we doing here? You know, we're trying to grasp something that maybe is a little hard, even with three-dimensional models to grasp. So if you just search on platonic solids, if you just search on phi proportion, particularly if you click the images button, because then you get the pictures right off the start, and there's a ton of stuff out there. And get your 11-year-olds to help you out, your 8-year-olds, they'll ask all the right questions, and it's a fun pursuit. Has been for me. So I want to thank you. Thank you so much. Thanks for coming.